So in this video, I want to show some of the blending techniques and materials that I use. There are artists that say you should never blend graphite. Some people even say it's cheating. There are the correct ways to blend, and there are ways that can get you in trouble. People can overblend and create a total mess of things, and blending can be done right. Blending is just a tool that you can have in your arsenal of tricks that you use to make things look realistic, that when done correctly, you can get more interesting textures, you can get softer values, you can create more realism. Even if realism isn't your goal, you can do more things with more tools than you can if for some reason you say you're not going to use all the tools that are available to you. To me, there are no rules in artwork. If you can make blending work for you, you should use blending. If it doesn't work for you, don't use blending. I use blending techniques. It's made my artwork pop better. It's made things look more realistic. And if you understand how to use the tool, there's no reason not to use the tool. You may already be familiar with some blending tools, and I'll start off by showing you some of the ones that are more common. Beginning with a stump. The stump is a rolled piece of paper. It's actually compressed paper, and it's rolled really tightly, and it has two ends on it. Another blending implement here is called a tortillion. It is usually smaller, and it only has one end on it, and it's not compressed paper. It's just rolled paper that's very, very tight. First of all, you have to be pretty careful with these blending tools because they can damage the paper, especially the tortillion here. It has a fairly hard tip on it. If you're not careful when you're blending, you can damage the tooth of the paper. And once that's compromised, it can't really be fixed. You can sometimes never be able to get back to a very nice smooth texture once you've damaged the paper. First of all, when I'm blending with the stump or a tortillion, I only blend in one direction. I don't go back and forth. And let me show you the reason for that. I'm just going to load up a stump here with a dark value so you can see this better. If I go back and forth, every place I start and stop, it's going to be a little bit darker than where I am on the move here. Let me demonstrate that here. I'm just going to make some zigzags here. Now hopefully you can see that it's much darker on the edges here than it is in the middle. And that has to do with a lot of the starts and stops you do. Now, so if I'm going back and forth like this, and I'm going to try to blend, a lot of times you'll end up with darker sides and a lighter in the middle. So I normally blend from dark to light. So I would start in the darkest area, just start a dark value here, and I blend towards the lighter area, like going from a shadow towards the light, and it gradually gets lighter as I proceed. If I was to use back and forth strokes, the area over here on the right is going to be just as dark as the area on the left. People use blending also if you have pencil lines on your paper and you want to blend them away. I also just go in one direction with those as well. And the most important thing is to use a light touch. See, I can blend those strokes away to where you can barely see them if I use a light touch. Some people think that you have to push very hard with any kind of blending tools to move that graphite or charcoal over. Actually, what happens if you push really hard? You grind those pencil lines into the paper and they won't come out. I'll just show another little example here of the pencil lines next to it here. Separate them a little so this will be easy to see. Now if I'm going to push really hard with this stump here, they don't tend to blend out as well. I'm just grinding those darker lines into the paper, and you also end up with start and stop marks too. So use a light touch. Also, using a light touch means that you can manipulate these values later. After they're blended, you'll be able to come in with a kneaded eraser or some of the other erasers I have. If it's done light enough, you'll be able to come back in and manipulate that. If you push down really hard, it's not going to come out nearly as easily. Now, the other blending tool that a lot of people are familiar with is a tortillion, and I treat it the same way as I do a stump. I don't use back and forth strokes. This is actually rougher on your paper than if you were to use a stump. So many times in my workshops, I see people that are get used to using a tortillion, and they just really damage that paper. You hear lots of scratchy noises like that, and the paper can actually end up getting damaged to where when you try to go over it with something else, that part of the damaged paper ends up being not acting like the rest of the paper. Another thing I want to mention about both a tortillion and a stump is they have fairly small points on them. So if I'm going to draw a large background of some kind, or if I'm going to put even shading in a face, like on the side of the face where the majority of it is dark, and you want a nice smooth tone, the last thing I would use is something that has a very small end on it. This would be like trying to paint your house with a tiny watercolor brush. You're not going to get a nice even tone anywhere with this. I try to pick something that is suitable for the subject I'm drawing. Using this to draw an entire black background would just be a waste of time. One other thing I want to show you with a stump and a tortillion, to help avoid pushing too hard and damaging the paper, what I normally do, as soon as I get a stump, I'll get a brand new one here, I'll take it off to the side of the paper and I'll sort of smash the end a little bit. I'm not pushing straight down on it, that would just smash it all in there. I'm just kind of softening up that end a little to where it's a little bit more pliable and can move back and forth. This just creates a softer tip. Now, don't do it on your paper like I'm doing here. I just want you to be able to see it on the camera. Now, once I get that tip much softer, I'll be able to blend without it damaging the paper as much, because I just can't push as hard because it's a little bit more pliable on the end. A tortillion, you can try to soften that end a little bit too. For the most part, these are just rougher, and in my opinion, they can end up damaging the paper much easier. And it's much harder to get a smooth texture with a tortillion because of all these ridges that are in here. That graphite or charcoal will get caught in those ridges and it won't be deposited evenly. That can make a real mess of any kind of smooth textures you're trying to create. So if you've been having a hard time getting smooth textures and you've been relying on a tortillion, you might want to put that away and hide it from yourself for a little bit and use some of these other blenders that I'm going to show you. Anything that you can use for pastel blending, you can use for charcoal or graphite blending. So there's a lot of these little tools that have little foam tips that you can buy in art stores that make excellent blenders, and one thing about them is they're much softer than a stump or a tortillion, and you won't damage the paper as much. Getting back to the tortillion for a second, if you do happen to push down and use it on its very tip, it'll have a tendency to collapse like that. You just notice how it's not as sharp as it was before, and then this is actually an even harder tip, which can damage the paper. If that happens, get yourself a paper clip and straighten it out. You can put this right in the end of the tortillion and push it out again, and you have a brand new tortillion. But even though you can fix these, try not to have that happen. If you're using it on the point, you're using it incorrectly, and you're probably damaging the paper. Now I want to show you a few other blending tools that I use that aren't quite as common. The first thing I'm going to do is cover up my paper so I don't get any oils from my hands on there. I'll be explaining that a little bit more in a future video. I'm going to start off by making just a strip of charcoal over here on the left using the Primo Elite Grande 5000 pencil. It's one that I mentioned in a previous video. The reason I'm going to use this pencil is it's just a very nice dark value
and it will help accentuate the different textures a little bit more that all of these different blending tools will create. You could do this same test with graphite. The softer the graphite, the more difference there will be between the blending materials. Again, through the magic of editing, you didn't have to watch me do that. Now I'm going to start off by showing you a chamois. A chamois creates the smoothest textures that I know how to create. You want to start off by using the part of the chamois that's the smoothest, not the rough side. And this is how I fold it. So it's folded once, and then I fold it again to make sort of a little triangle or kind of a point to it. Then I sort of roll it up on each side a little bit, so I don't have any of those folds on the bottom where it's going to be touching the paper. I'm going to start off by doing a little circular blending through this strip of charcoal here, and then some swipes across the paper to show you how once that charcoal is applied to the various blenders, creates different textures. So here I go. As you can see, that makes a pretty nice smooth texture there. Now over here on the side, I'm going to add a little bit more in a circular pattern. And a chamois is also good for lightening values. I need to get to a clean place of the chamois here, and by going over this again, it will lighten that value. It can be used like an eraser. It'll make a nice, even, soft, smooth value. The next blender I want to show you is a paper towel. The name of this kind of paper towel is Brawny, and it says on the package that it's cloth-like or most like cloth or something like that. And I fold it the same way, starting off with a little triangle, rolled up on each side, and keep the folds away from the part that I'm going to be using. I'll do the same test here. See, this ends up making a slightly rougher texture than the chamois above it there. This next one I want to show you is a piece of felt. You can buy these felt squares at just about any fabric store or even Walmart or Kmart. They come in a 12 inch by 12 inch square. I usually cut into quarters. Now another reason I fold these blending tools like this is it creates more of a cushion between my finger and the paper and keeps me from pushing too hard, which can be a problem. If you push too hard on any of these blenders, you won't be able to manipulate the texture they make afterwards. If you're going to try this at home, I want you to use a very light touch while you're doing this. This piece of felt is what I use to create really nice rough textures. And with all of these blending materials, going over them with a different blender will create a slightly different texture. For instance, if I go over any of these with a stump or a tortillon afterwards or before, it creates something different than just using one particular blender. There are many combinations you can use. This one creates lots of little dots and dashes that can be manipulated into creating really interesting textures. The next one I'll show you is actually a piece of printer paper, just a regular piece of paper that I'm going to tear into a size that I can manage. This one I just wrap around my finger a little bit. I'll do the same test here. Now what this blender does is bring out the texture of the paper more. So depending on how smooth or rough your paper is, this creates a totally different texture. So there you have it, four totally different blending materials that get totally different textures. Now you could try to spend all day trying to create these textures with just a pencil, not using any blending at all. Some of these textures would be impossible to do. In future videos, I'll show how these basic blending techniques can be used to create very realistic textures in real drawings. Not all of these free videos will be available on YouTube because of their time restrictions, so don't forget to sign up on my email list so you don't miss any. Thanks for watching!